Hello, I'm E. Ethelbert Miller. Welcome to The Scholars, a television interview series that explores contemporary scholarship. We hope to engage and challenge your thinking on a broad range of topics. You'll meet a diverse group of scholars who are investigating and thinking about our complex and changing world. Dana Flor is a documentary and director and producer based in Washington, D.C. She co-directed and produced The Nine Lives of Marion Barry. Currently, she is co-directing and co-producing a feature film called Check It, about a black gay gang in D.C. Dana, welcome to The Scholars.
Thank you.
You know, a very big question. When did film become a central part of your life?
That's tricky. Film, I guess probably about, 10 to 15 years ago. I mean, I came from news. I was a news producer. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't call that film,
right.
Although I've always been a film buff.
Okay. So you're a very visual person.
Yeah, I'm visual. I mean, to be honest, I think I'm more interested in the content than the visuals. I'm more interested in the story itself. That's the first thing that pulls me in.
You know, when you say that, I know many people, when they talk about movies, they think like Hollywood, but you just said the story. So I guess you're really concerned about like documenting things.
Well, I'm a documentary film producer. I'm not a feature. I don't work in fiction.
Is that something that you would hope that more people would move into that area?
In documentary filmmaking? Right. I think there's a lot of people there, but yeah, I encourage people to make films. It's a very exciting thing to do, and I think there's a real need for it to get important stories out there.
What are some of the stories that you feel people should explore more? And I say that in terms of sometimes race or gender issues that you say, okay, you know, no one's talking about this. You know, I know these stories, maybe I grew up with these stories around me in my household, but someone needs to tell these stories.
The stories that you pick and choose when you're doing a film are incredibly personal. So I know the stories that I want to do, and I know the stories that attract me, but I can't speak for other people. And the stories that I want to be put out there are the stories that I'm doing.
How do you get people to open up or talk about their secrets? Or, for example, you know, something is taking place in a community and all of a sudden now you, the filmmaker, come along and you see it and you bring it to light.
It's a tricky and complicated relationship between the filmmaker and the subject. I think it all has to do with trust. I mean, you're building trust between you and your subject, and it takes time. Hmm. It takes time.
Now, when you say that trust, does that mean that if you identify, say, me as a subject, right?
Mm-hmm.
Before we even think about bringing the camera in, we might be talking so that we just get to know each other? Is that the type
sure.
of trust you want to build?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we'd never just start off filming. I mean, you definitely get to know the subject, get to know the terrain of the story that you're doing. And I also think that, you know, you want to show people that the kind of work you do is not kind of the gotcha kind of mm-hmm. journalism,
right.
That you're trying to tell the truth and you're trying to be fair. Mm-hmm. I think that that's a point that we really try to make.
Right. What happens if, for example, you gain that trust, right? You have the camera going. It's so much trust that people really open up to you.
Mm-hmm.
But then when they see it, they say, well, wait a minute, you know, I didn't want to be that open. Can you cut that? Can you cut that? To what point now are they affecting your film?
That's also a really tricky part, is when the subject or the subjects of your film get to see the film itself. I mean, the subjects have no editorial control over what's done. So really, ultimately, the decision is ours. But you want to be fair. And you also want to explain to the person why what you're putting in is important for the story. I think if I had a subject that was adamantly against something in the film for a legitimate reason, I think that we'd consider taking it out. If it's something central to the story, it would be difficult. But it's a very sort of tricky, complicated dance that you do between filmmaker and subjects, and it's fascinating. And to add to that, I mean, it's a relationship. It's not a quick relationship. Documentaries take years to make.
Right.
So the relationships that you're developing with your subjects are often very profound.
Now, how important are your research skills, or do you bring people in who are good researchers to work with you?
When I speak of we, I'm talking about my partner, Toby
right.
Oppenheimer. We work together. We do everything ourselves in terms of research. The film that I'm working on right now is not so much historical. For Marion Barry, I did all the research, and I love that part of it. I really love that part of it.
And do you bring in young people to help, like interns, people?
Yeah, sure. We have interns. We have interns, but we're a really small shop.
Okay. Now, in terms of small shops, what are the concerns there in terms of, you know, going out and seeking funds, you know, building up a track record? What are some of the problems that you encounter just in terms of saying, I have this idea for a film, but it's going to cost?
It's really hard to get money to do a documentary. Full stop. It's just really difficult. It's even more difficult if you choose topics that are kind of edgy and polemic and touch on themes that are not easy for people to talk about. It makes it more difficult. Having said that, we've been incredibly lucky. We've gotten grants from Tribeca, from Pere Lawrence. I've got a grant from DC Arts and Humanities. So we're very blessed to have that support.
So that also means that you have very good proposal writing skills.
I think so, Okay. Yeah. I mean, the proposal is a whole other thing. The proposal is extraordinarily important. You have to be able to write really well, and it takes a really long time. And it's a great thing. I think it's a wonderful thing in the process of doing a documentary, because when you write up a proposal, they ask about every single thing. And before you actually make a full feature-length documentary, you really should have an answer to all of those questions. Why are you making the film? Who's your audience? There's a lot of very specific questions that you have to ask, have to answer in a proposal. And it's good for the filmmaker to get those, you know, questions sort of solved. Some things can't be answered in the process of doing a documentary film, because it's real life. You don't know how it's going to end. Sure. You don't know what they're going to do. Yeah. There's a lot of surprises, but you have to, you know, you have to lay out the structure, your intentions, what the themes are in a proposal, and it's very helpful. Now, it's a lot of work.
What about the budget? Because that's going to be a key part of it. You're dealing with, say, a budget that could change for a number of different reasons, okay? How much do you ask for? You know, what goes into making a good budget for say, one of your last films?
Well, I mean, the way that we did the Barry film, for example, is we did it all on our own. I mean, I started the film alone for the first 3 years. It was just me out there filming. So the costs are low. It's difficult to do, though, because you're often working another job, which I was, and my partner was when we were working. It was the two of us doing it. And so we worked on our own, and then we got funding. Frequently, you have to do that because in order to pitch a film, frequently they want to see it. They want to see something, a trailer or something. That's the way we've done it. You know, the whole process, there's a million different ways to do it. Mm-hmm. I can only talk about how I've done it, but everybody has a different, it depends on how you're funded, who you're funded by, what your audience is, where is it going? Is it going to HBO? Is it going to NBC? All of that is different. So it's very particular things, and it could be very different.
Now, do you own your own equipment, or are you renting equipment for particular?
We own it. Yeah, we own it. And right now, actually, we're using some equipment of our executive producers.
And how has, over the years, how has equipment changed? For example, you know, like lighting and a lot of stuff is digital. I mean, your profession has really been hit with the technology changes.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Is it much more fun in terms of things that you can imagine doing that you couldn't do years ago?
Yeah, I mean, I think as a woman, it's particularly gratifying to know that now I can almost hold a camera. I mean, the old cameras, right, seriously, they were about 35 pounds. Yeah. And so that kind of separated most women from using that. I couldn't have physically done that. I think now we can physically do that. So it's much smaller.
That's interesting. Yeah.
It's smaller. It's digital. Yeah, it's a whole different world than when I started out.
Now, you're also doing, I remember I was out one time, you're also a photographer, you're doing your own shooting.
Not so much.
Not that much,
no.
Okay.
I mean, I take pictures, but I do not consider myself a photographer.
Right.
No, and I actually don't, I mean, I'm not a cinematographer by any stretch of the imagination, but I have to be.
Right.
So, I mean, I am, because a lot of my film, there's footage in the films, but I don't consider myself. I mean, my partner, Toby, is much, that's his job. But when I have to do it, I do it.
Now, looking where you are right now, if you were to give advice to another young person, what would you encourage that person to, say, study and learn? We've just talked about budgets and writing and things of that sort. Are there other things that a person should begin to pursue if they want to become a documentary filmmaker?
I encourage young people to make a film. Just go make a film. There's no excuse in this day and age for you not to make a film. You've got everything you need. You can make a film on a phone. So the only way to learn how to make a film is to make a film. There's no better way to learn. Okay. In terms of learning, I mean, I think a broad knowledge of the world is always very helpful. But if you want to make a film, make a film.
Well, talking about a broad knowledge of the world, I always see documentary filmmakers as having a point of view, that many times that even the selection of the topic is a political decision. What's your politics?
What's my politics? That's such a broad question. I can't really answer that.
Maybe be specific.
Yeah, I mean.
Well, what I'm saying is that if you went in into a voting booth, I mean, would you check that you're conservative?
Well, I can tell you how I vote.
Well, no. Okay, it's just a.
It's a private space, the voting booth.
There's no more private space. But what I'm saying, you know, would you, if you look at your body of work, would you see yourself as being a progressive filmmaker in terms of just the things that you're tackling? And that's progressive in quotes.
I don't even know what progressive means anymore.
Well, let's take a look.
Yes. If I have to use that word, I would consider myself progressive. Okay. I think that each film, there's a theme that pulls me in. Sometimes I don't even know what that theme is, and I figured it out in the process of doing a film. But of course, your own personal convictions and what you're interested in influences how you make a film, definitely. I don't have a specific axe to grind, and all the films that I'm interested in are playing off of that theme. I think every story is really, really different.
Okay, The Nine Lives of Marion Barry. Why do a film of Marion Barry? What was your politics going into saying, I'm going to do this film on Marion Barry, knowing what was going on in the city?
I don't see it so much as political. I'm first drawn to a character in a story. Okay. And to me, he was such an amazing character. A once-in-a-lifetime kind of character. And his story had every element you could possibly want in a film. Mm. So, and it hadn't been done. And so, I wondered why had it not been done?
Were you trying to tell the story of just Marion Barry, or were you also trying to tell the story of the city?
It's definitely the story of the city. The city is a character in that film, and the city is a character in our present film as well. It looms large, definitely.
How did he respond to the film in terms of, one, did you have to convince him that you wanted him to do it?
yes. Marion Barry did not want to have a film made about him.
Why?
You never know with Marion. Why did he not want? I guess it was a question again of trust. I think that he didn't know who I was. He didn't know what I wanted to do. He didn't know what my intentions were, and that was his immediate.
Did you have somebody introduce you to him, or?
I did. I actually stalked him for a while. It was really hard. He just did not want to talk to me, and so I met a lot of his very close friends, and I was really fortunate to meet someone who's no longer with us, Lawrence Guillot.
Right.
They worked together in SNCC, and they had gone way back to Mississippi. And Guillot knew the kind of story that I wanted to do, and he knew that Barry would probably be interested in talking to me if he knew that. So Guillot actually called me one day, and he said, "Where are you? What are you doing? Barry's at the Mayflower, and he's having lunch. You got to go right now and meet him right now, because he's sitting there alone. He had a meeting, he's sitting there alone." So I'm like, oh, God. So I went, and I just showed up, and that's how we met. Mm-hmm. And it started from there. He wasn't particularly friendly, but he wasn't rude. He's never rude.
You tell him what you wanted to do? I did.
I mean, I just wanted to meet him. You know, you need that face-to-face time. It's very crucial, you know. And I just laid out a little bit of what the ideas were that I had. And then as the lunch started to end, he said, you know, "All right, well, I'm going to Mississippi if you want to come tomorrow." And I was like, "I'm sorry, what?" And he said, I'm going to Mississippi. I got to visit my, I'm going to Tennessee and Mississippi. I'm visiting my mom who was in the hospital. If you want to come, come." And I was like, wow. So I did, and that was kind of where our relationship started.
Now, you also had to rely on footage and things of that sort, you know. Was that difficult to obtain? Because I remember at one time people weren't saving things at some of the TV stations. No. They were just taping over stuff.
No, they're not. I love that part of the whole process. it's like a treasure hunt. It's hard. It's really hard. Getting rights to use the footage mm-hmm. is a whole nother issue. But I love that. And we were able to find pieces of film that were going to be thrown away in lots of different places. Mm-hmm. I got stuff out of people's attics. That was a really fun part. So, and we have magical footage.
So I guess people must have started, once they heard about this, people probably were starting opening up, like, you know, going up to the attics and pulling things for
Oh,
you.
God, no, it's never that easy. It's never that easy. Nobody's like, hello. No, I found people that were significantly involved in the Barry story in some way, shape, or mm-hmm. form. And one reporter, for example, had kept all of his work, mm-hmm. and he had covered Barry for years and years and years. Reporters, close friends of his, all kinds of different people that we found would say, oh, well, maybe we have that. And then, you know, little by little, you get stuff here and there. But it's a lot of work. And the movie took years to make, but it was a good thing that it took as long as it did, because we were able to amass the largest collection of the Barry footage that exists. And there's just some amazing stuff. A lot of stuff didn't make the cut. Mm. Wonderful stuff.
Well, you know what I saw when I looked at it? I saw, okay, here you are telling a story. And then I looked at people like Tom Sherwood and Jeanetta Barrett, who would write books about Barry because they have their own story.
Yep.
How do you pull all those streams together?
Well, again, it's your point of view, and you're sort of stringing together. The Barry film also was stringing together different voices, and that different point of view was essential. That's what we wanted. We wanted to make a balanced story. We wanted to show the different points of view, and surely by the Tom Sherwood's opinion of Barry is far different than Jonetta's, you know, view. So we wanted to get those different voices, different opinions throughout the city.
Well, how did you interact with your subject and the material? Because here we have, when you talk about Marion Barry, race comes up. You're not African American. You're a woman, so that could affect the thing where perhaps he'd be more open to talking to you as opposed to a man as mm-hmm. filmmaker. How did you sort of meander through those sort of issues?
I go back to character. Race, gender, so many things, of course, affect the way you look at anything. I can't look at it in any other way as you can, mm-hmm. right? But you're thinking about story and you're thinking about character. I think that once you have a relationship with someone and you see them as a person, race and gender, especially with Barry, it really truly wasn't an issue. There were other issues, I didn't feel like it didn't get in the way. And race is central to the story. I'm not diminishing the role of race in the story, but as a relationship between myself and Barry, I didn't feel like it was an issue, and I don't think he would.
When he first saw the film, were you there with him in terms of that, and what was his response?
That was a really amazing night. I was very scared to show Barry the film. It's a very scary moment, mm-hmm. you know? Because let's face it, doing a documentary, being the subject of a documentary, it's very intimate, you know? I would never have someone do a documentary about me. I wouldn't do it.
I'm glad you're on a show right now.
Exactly, I'm a very private person. So I understand how difficult it would be to have a documentary made about you. So it was in his house, he was with some friends, and he was very quiet as he saw the film.
Oh, okay.
He was very quiet.
Was it painful in terms of parts of it?
Yeah, and after the film ended, it was very quiet, and he was kind of teary, and he sort of whispered. He was like, you did a good job, mm-hmm. you know? But then the next morning, he called me up, and he was so pissed off at me. He was so angry. And he was like, well, you know, some parts of it were good, but you're going to have to change like half of it, you know? Mm. And the film was coming out like maybe a week and a half from the point that he saw it. It was coming out shortly after he had seen the film, so I was like, well, that can't happen. But at any rate, Barry's opinion about the film changed constantly. Sometimes he loved it, sometimes he hated it. He certainly loved the attention. I think the most painful thing about the film to him was to hear about Effie, because when the film came out, Effie had passed away. And so I think it was very difficult for him to hear. It was really the first time that Effie had really spoken about Barry and their relationship. Very intimate details, very raw, very honest. It was one of the most amazing interviews I've ever done. And I think it blew him away.
What would you expect people today with this city changing? You see this film as being very important to say, if you moved here and you want to know what's going on, do you have to, should you look at this film? Does it tell you something about where our city's going?
I think it should be mandatory. It's not just because I made the film. I think that that we captured a piece of the city and a moment in time that is vanishing so rapidly. Well, it's gone. It's gone. Barry's gone. Mm-hmm. He's no longer with us. So I think we're very proud to have captured a chunk of history. And in terms of the city, that part of the city, it doesn't really exist anymore.
Where did you turn, I mean, you gather a lot of things. Do you deposit the things that you, like things that you might have not used to any particular institution, like archives or anything?
I want to expand on that last question you asked, though. Sorry about that. But I think in terms of people seeing that film, I think it's really important because to understand how DC works, you have to understand the history and where it comes from. And we go through that in the film. And Barry sort of embodied so many important changes of that. So I think it's really important, especially for newcomers of the city, to see where the city was and how rapidly it's changing. And there's a lot of resentment from a lot of people that you feel in the air, at least I feel it. And you can sort of understand why if you see the film as well.
Did your opinion of Barry change during the making of the film?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, again, it's a very curious relationship between a subject and a filmmaker. He's a very difficult man to deal with. I'm not gonna lie to you. I mean, you know, for every 10 times we arranged a meeting with Barry, he probably showed up to 3, and those 3 times he made us wait like 4 hours for him. So it was very difficult. Very difficult. He's very media savvy. Because of that, he was careful a lot of times. But there were times that he wasn't careful, and those are the most magical times in the film itself. Sometimes he'd get mad at me. Sometimes I'd get mad at him. He'd get sick to death of us because we dog him. We were with him all the time. It's a relationship that expands and you know, it's complicated. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad, and it's over the course of years. So,
Well, relationships are key to the film that you're working on now. Check It. Talk a little bit about that film.
Yeah, okay, well, we're working on our film that we hope that will come out in the fall or at the latest in the winter. It's about a black gay gang here in D.C. And it's the story of, we profile 4 of the kids in the gang over the course of 3 years. And once again, trust is essential. It's essential. And that relationship takes time and took time. And again, it can be difficult.
How did you come about choosing this topic? And I mean, did you hear about this gang, or did somebody introduce you to one of the members? What happened in terms of the selection process for this being your next film?
Actually, I was working on a film that's still in my drawer, like those novels that you're going to write, because I'm going to write it, about Go-Go. So in working on the Go-Go film, I was talking to Ron Moten, who's a Go-Go, works with Go-Go, promotes Go-Go. He was like, look, Go-Go's great, it's fantastic, it's going to be a great film, but you have to meet these kids that I'm working with, because he works with gangs around the city and conflict resolution. And he said, you have to meet them. He told me a little bit about them. And we sat down and we met them and we were blown away. Just blown away.
You're dealing with young people. Are you concerned about, you know, a film freezing them at a particular point in time in their lives? And, you know, that's how they will be seen?
You're always concerned about how a film will affect the lives of your subjects. It's a huge responsibility. And especially when they're as young as these kids. We would never put these kids in a negative light, and we don't. So I think that's the answer to your question. Another thing is important to say, we haven't finished the film. So it's hard for me to talk about the particulars of the film, but it's not done yet. We're still working on it.
Okay, well, Dana, it's come to the end of our interview, and so I can't work on any more questions. So, Dana, thanks for joining me on The Scholars. Thank you for watching. I'm E. Ethelbert Miller.